grams transferred everything. Question. behaving as an You see that we have 6 grams of this chemical. Perhaps we should take a look at the structure of that chemical. CH3C double bond O. Ethanoic anhydride. This chemical here will react in a similar way to ammonia. Think of one of the H's being replaced by the phenyl group C6H5. What's going to happen is it's going to break across here, and the H will go on this side, giving us the ethanoic acid, and the remainder of that molecule, C6H5NH, will go on the top end, producing this product. So reacting 6 grams of ethanoic anhydride with 4 grams of phenylamine, and 3.8 grams of this product is formed. We're required to work out the percentage yield. This summarizes the data. Have a go. Need to work out the relative molecular masses of these chemicals, which I believe to be 102. And I think 135 here. Convert to mole, we divide the mass by the relative molecular mass, so this will be 6.0 over 102. That comes out to be 0.059 moles. This will be 4.0 divided by 93, and that comes out to be 0.043. We see that this chemical is in excess, given that they react in equimolar amounts, 1 mole to 1 mole. So this chemical will limit the amount of product formed and our answer will therefore be based on the phenylamine. In theory, we should end up with the same number of moles of this, namely 0.043 moles. Let's work out what 0.043 moles of this chemical would be. It would be that number of moles times its relative molecular mass, 135 grams, and that comes out to be 5.805. That's what we should get if we had 100% yield. It's known as the theoretical yield. This is the practical yield, what we got in practice. And the percentage yield then is equal to the practical yield over the theoretical yield multiplied by 100%. So that gives us 3.8 divided by 5.805 times 100%. And that comes out to be 65.46, according to my calculations. I may have maybe want to figure out or something there, but let's see if I go back to the original question, see which one of these is the closest fit. And C is the closest fit. The answer is C. Moving on to the next question, pause and have a go. Copper reacting with nitric acid, conch sulfuric acid with potassium iodide, cyanyl chloride with ethanoic acid, and sodium sulfite with potassium permanganate, the oxidizing agent. We're looking for the one that produces no gas. Quick look at each of these. When copper is added to concentrated nitric acid, it wouldn't be pure nitric acid, but concentrated, we get a blue solution of copper nitrate, brown nitrogen dioxide gas, and water. This is the copper here going into the colourless clear concentrated nitric acid. It goes through this stage and then eventually produces a blue solution, which is the blue solution of copper nitrate. The brown gas you see here is nitrogen dioxide, NO2. This gives a more full account of what's happening. It goes through two stages. First of all, the copper forms a copper complex with nitrate acting as a ligand. But then in the second step here, the nitrate ligands are replaced by water ligands, producing this blue complex solution. So the key thing is we do get a gas here, so this is not our answer. When it comes to the reaction of conch sulfuric acid with the sodium halides, this is an important aspect of group 7 chemistry. You should be able to discuss the reactions of conch sulfuric acid with these sodium or potassium halides and be able to consider the relative reducing ability of the hydrogen halides by the concentrated sulfuric acid, which can behave as an oxidizing agent. You should be familiar in terms of going down the group, fluorine, chlorine, bromine, iodine, that we can form, if we use X to represent the halide ion, we can react that with concentrated sulfuric acid to get the hydrogen halide, HX, and sodium hydrogen sulfate. In the case of sodium fluoride, that will produce hydrogen fluoride with the conch sulfuric acid. In the case of sodium chloride, that will produce hydrogen chloride. In the case of the sodium bromide, it'll produce hydrogen bromide. In the case of sodium iodide, it'll produce hydrogen iodide. Now, concentrated sulfuric acid will not oxidize hydrogen fluoride or hydrogen chloride, but it does oxidize hydrogen bromide and hydrogen iodide, which means that you will get a range of other products. Let's look at the detail of this with particular regard for the, in this particular case, the bromide. Again, this is the particular reaction that takes place, forming initially hydrogen bromide. But the hydrogen bromide will go on to be oxidized and produce bromine, which will come off as a vapor or gas. So once again, we're getting a gas, and this is not the answer. With hydrogen iodide, it goes on to be oxidized and produces iodine, as well as sulfur dioxide, and indeed other products as well. So with it, you would also get a gas. The third alternative involved thionyl chloride. Thionyl chloride, you should know, is a good chlorinating agent, as is PCl5. Now, the particular reaction we had here was with ethanoic acid, but it'll be similar to the one with ethanol here. If you react with thionyl chloride, which is SOCl2, in this case you'll get the acyl chloride form, CH3COCl, plus SO2 and HCl. So again, you're getting, in this case, two gases. This is therefore not the answer either. It has to be the last one, which was this one, sodium sulfite with concentrated sulfuric acid. Sorry, with potassium permanganate, I should say. I've provided the two half-cell reactions that are relevant here. This is known to be a strong oxidizing agent. When it behaves as an oxidizing agent, it means it undergoes reduction, so it shouldn't be surprising that it has the larger reduction potential and will indeed undergo reduction, as shown here, the gaining of electrons. It means then that this one will be reversed and undergo oxidation. We will have the sulfide ions being oxidized to sulfate ions. You should be able to write a balanced redox equation from these. You would balance your electrons by multiplying this equation by 5 to get 10 electrons, and multiplying this equation by 2 to get 10 electrons, and then you could add them together. In any case, you can see that no gas is formed in this particular redox reaction. There you see those particular half-cell reactions combined. This is reversed and multiplied by 5. This one's multiplied by 2. We have 5 water molecules on the left here and 8 here, so we can cancel out 5 of them to leave 3H2O. The 10E minus on both sides cancel. We can also cancel some of these hydrogens, leaving 6H plus on this side. A short story made long by way of revision, but the essential thing is that none of the products are gaseous, so this is our answer to the original question. Moving on, pause and have a go. An excellent reaction to use to illustrate molecularity or the kinetics of reactions. This is shown as a 3-step reaction. In fact, some sources would show this as a whole series of reactions. Let's take a brief look at this. This is our propanone here, and the H3O, which is a H3O plus, which is the correct way of showing the acid. The acid, of course, has hydrogen ions, but hydrogen ions pair up with water molecules to form hydroxonium ions. Now this is the first, it's the slow step. All the other steps are fast. And it's the slow step that's the bottleneck in the process. It's known as the rate determining step. And it's very important to focus in on this slow step. And you notice that it involves one molecule of the propanone and one molecule of the acid, as represented by the H3O+. It has no molecules of iodine involved, and we'll see this is important in our discussion. taken from the Nock-Hardy notes. Many reactions consist of a series of separate stages. Each stage or step has its own rate, or rate constant. The overall rate of a multi-step process is governed by the slowest step, the bottleneck. Liken this to a production line, where the overall output can be held back by a slow worker. It's known as the rate-determining step. If there's more than one step, the rate equation may not contain all the reactants in its format. So we're going to see in this particular case the rate equation doesn't have one of the reactants, namely iodine. Why? Well, here's the iodine. We can see it's involved in the balanced or stoichiometric equation forming the products. Yet it doesn't show up in the rate equation. Conversely, the acid represented by H3O plus or H plus doesn't appear in the stoichiometric equation, but does appear in the rate equation. You can see why this is an excellent reaction to take to illustrate what happens in kinetics. So returning to the question again, which one's the right answer? The answer is A. First order with respect to the propanone. Why? Because one molecule of propanone was involved in the slow or rate determining step. Similarly, for the acid, represented by either H plus or H3O plus, one of its molecules was involved in the rate determining step. It is therefore first order with respect to it. In regard to the other reactant, iodine, none of its molecules were involved in the slow step, and as a result, the reaction is zero order with respect to iodine. The concentration of iodine has no influence on the rate of the reaction, so long as some of it is present. Moving on. Pause and have a go. This is to do with salt hydrolysis. A salt is made up of two ions. One can be seen as coming from a base, the other from an acid. We've got to find out which one will provide or give the highest pH. You might find this table helpful. I've split these ions up, ammonium chloride, ammonium ethanoate, and so on. We need to consider whether these particular ions have come from a strong base, strong or weak base, strong or weak acid. Well, ammonium, which can be seen as coming from the weak base, ammonium hydroxide. So in terms of the question, has it come from a strong base? The answer is no. What about the chloride ion? It's come from an acid. Which acid? Hydrochloric acid. Answering the question, is this a strong acid? Yes. So the acid dominates in this particular case. So here the pH is going to be below 7. Again, no in terms of coming from a strong base. Ethanoate, this is from the weak acid, ethanoic acid, so that in answering this question, it's no. So weak base, weak acid, we would expect a pH of 7. Sodium, considered as coming from the strong alkali sodium hydroxide, so in answering the question, yes, it has come from a strong base. Chloride from hydrochloric acid, strong acid, so yes. Again, strong base, strong acid, so we'd expect the pH of sodium chloride solution to be 7. Strong base, yes. Strong acid, no. This time the base dominates, so we'd expect the pH to be above 7. And this is the answer to our question here. The sodium ethanoate will give a solution with the highest pH value. Moving on. Pause and have a go, please. Air is considered in this case to be 20% oxygen. We're taking 10 cubic decimeters of this. What volume will we need of this? Notice the ratio in terms of moles, 4 to 5. We'll use Avogadro's principle here, namely that equal moles of different gases occupy this summarizes the key information here. So have a go. Well, if 4 produces 5, what will 10 produce? If we considered that air was pure oxygen, then 10 would be 5 over 4. We'd have to multiply it by 5 over 4. But we've also got to multiply it by 5. We'll need 5 times as much because air is only 1/5 oxygen. So we multiply it by 5 again. So that's 10 times 5 times 5. That's 250 over 4. In order to oxidize water, you see the water here, we're going to have this equation reversed. It's going therefore to have to be coupled with something with a larger reduction potential, and this is the one with a larger reduction potential. And the species that's going to bring about the oxidation is the species that will undergo reduction in that particular half-cell reaction, and this is the species that undergoes the reduction. The answer is therefore D. Okay, moving on now to section B and the 5 structured questions. Pause and have a go. Here's the answer coming up. Feeding solution is a solution of copper. Copper 2+. And aldehydes, unlike ketones, are capable of reducing it to insoluble copper 1, forming this brick red precipitate of copper 1 oxide. Simply wanted red precipitate. Precipitate's important. This is a suspension here. You just about make out the particles, perhaps, of precipitate. Moving on. Pause and have a go. Optically active. If you're ready, let's take a brief look at how we work out the substance is optically active. We use this device known as a polarimeter. This represents diffuse light. In other words, it has light in all planes. If we pass diffuse light through a polarizing filter, it will separate out light in one plane. We have what is known as a beam of plane polarizing. moving on, pause and have a go, please. This is the product. Draw it out on its side here, like so. We've got that N going to the H. Let's not forget the, see where we've got these nitro groups. Should be one here, two and four. Got this nitrogen here, and then it goes to a double bond to that carbon. And then whatever the moving on. what will the rate equation be then? Rate is equal to K, lowercase k, times the concentration of NO raised to the power of 2 because it's second order, times the concentration of oxygen. It's second order with respect to NO, so how would its concentration change with time? Will it stay like that? Will it fall in a linear way, or will it fall in a curved way? Well, being second order, it's going to fall in a curved manner like that. Had it been first order, it would have fallen in a linear fashion like that. And what about the rate? How will it be influenced by the concentration of NO? Because it's second order, it's going to go up something like that. It's going to be curved like that. Moving on. There you see the answers. Pause and have a go here. You're going to have to get those figures. Let's go back to the table. You're going to need them to do this here. The results of experiment 1. So notice here it's by 10 to the minus 3 in both cases, and by 10 to the minus 4 here. So it's 6 by 10 to the minus 4 is the rate, and these are both 1 by 10 to the minus 3, in other words 0.001. So rate is equal to K times the concentration of NO squared times the concentration of O2. We can rearrange that so that K is equal to the rate divided by the concentration of NO raised to the power of 2 times the concentration of oxygen. We should also work out the units. The units are going to be, rate is always mole per cubic decimeter per second. And on the bottom line, we've got mole per cubic decimeter squared times mole per cubic decimeter. Well, those will cancel with those, leaving seconds to the minus 1 on the top line. So we've got seconds to the minus 1 on the top, and we've got moles per cubic decimeter all squared, which would be moles squared dm to the minus 6. And we can bring those to the top line, which we give as seconds to the minus 1. Moles will be, we have to change the sign of the indice when we bring it to the top, so that'd be mole to the minus 2 dm to the 6. As long as you get these right, the sequence is not important. And we put our values in. The rate was 6 by 10 to the minus 4, so that's 0.0006 over 1 by 10 to the minus 3 in both cases, so that's 0.001 squared times 0.001. And if you work all of that out, what does that come out to be? 600,000, which is 6 by 10 to the 5 seconds to the minus 1 mole to the minus 2 dm to the 6. And have a go at this, please. The effect of reducing the pressure. If you get it right, you won't get the mark unless you can explain the answer. Here's the answer coming up then. It pushes the equilibrium to the right hand side. If you drop the pressure, by Le Chatelier's principle, the reaction that opposes that change will begin to occur faster. In other words, the one that brings the pressure up. And you've got to explain that the forward reaction increases the number of molecules and thereby relieves the constraint or brings the pressure back up again, increases the pressure. And the answer was 6 by 10 to the 5 seconds to the minus 1 moles to the minus 2 dm to the 6. Pause and have a go, please. looking at this equilibrium N2O4 in equilibrium with 2NO2. The total pressure is 125 kilopascal, and the mole fraction, the total has to come to be 1. If you add up all the mole fractions, it should be clearly a total of 1.0. It's given us the mole fraction equilibrium of the N2O4 is 0.2, that's the mole fraction, which means that the mole fraction at equilibrium for the NO2 has to be 0.8. Now the pressure exerted by each gas is a factor of its mole fraction, so the partial pressure contributed by the N2O4 is going to be 0.2 times the total pressure, 125 kilopascal. If we're looking here at this partial pressure, I'll use PP for that, and it'll be in kilopascals, small k, whereas this is going to be 0.8 times 125. This comes out to be 25, and this is 100. We now have the partial pressures, so we can put that into the expression for the Kp. It's going to be the partial pressure of the NO2 raised to the power of 2, because of the 2 here in the stoichiometric equation, divided by the partial pressure of the N2O4. So that's going to be 100 squared over 25. So that's 1, 2, 3, 4 divided by 25. That goes into that 4 times, 400. So the answer is 400. We need to look at the units as well. We've got kilopascals on the top line squared divided by kilopascals. The square term will cancel with that, so the unit will be kilopascals, 400 kilopascals. And try this part, part 3. If the effect of increasing the temperature on the value of the equilibrium constant. We can see here, importantly, from this sentence that when we warm it, it's causing this to decompose, in fact considerably so, because the mole fraction of the product on the right is 0.8. So clearly increasing the temperature pushes the equilibrium to the right hand side. What does that tell us about the energetics of the forward reaction? The Kp value increases as the equilibrium moves to the right. That should make sense, since the NO2 part of the expression is on the top line. And the explanation then is because it removes the excess thermal energy, because the forward reaction is endothermic or whatever. But note that you must come up with the explanation to get this other mark. Brief look at this chemistry here. This is a flask with this very equilibrium. It's got both NO2, which is brown, and N2O4, which is colourless. The more the equilibrium lies to the right in favour of NO2, then the darker the flask will appear. If you take this flask and let's say you take two of this, or three identical flasks, leave one at room temperature, place one in an ice water bath, place one in a hot water bath. This is what they look like moments later. The one put in the ice water bath has got lighter in colour, which is an indication that more of this is forming and less of this. When you raise the temperature, you favour the endothermic process. The endothermic process was the forward reaction, which produces more of the coloured NO2, which explains this flask. And then the reverse is true here. When you put it into an ice water bath, it's going to favor the exothermic reaction, which is a reaction which produces more of the colorless N2O4 and less of the brown NO2 gas. Moving on to the next question. Pause and have a go, please. The relative strength of these oxyacids is down to the oxidation number of the nitrogen in this case. What's the oxidation number of the nitrogen in the two acids? Here it's +5 and here it's +3. Let's just do that in one instance to remind you how that works, how we get the oxidation number. If we take HNO3, oxidation number of oxygen is always -2 except for the peroxides. The oxidation number of hydrogen is always +1 apart from the hydrides. The overall molecule is neutral. There are three oxygens with -2, so that's 3 times -2, -6. And there's one hydrogen +1. We have to ask ourselves what goes in here to make the sum come out to be correct, and clearly it's a +5. We do the same with the nitrous acid, the nitrogen is +3. So on the basis of that, we get a mark for saying it is the nitric acid is a stronger acid, and we explain that in terms of the nitrogen having a higher oxidation state in the nitric acid than in the nitrous acid. And have a go at this, please. Okay, so we're adding nitric acid, which means that we have to keep this equation in this direction. We have to stick with this. It has to undergo reduction, which means that it has to have the bigger reduction potential. So right away I'm going to ignore this reaction, because if it was coupled with the bottom reaction, then in fact this would happen in reverse. So that means that I focus in on the first and second reactions, because the middle reaction, the one involving the nitric acid undergoing reduction, therefore it's behaving as an oxidizing agent, when coupled with this reaction will be reversed. So we also then need to balance up the electrons. There's only the first equation and 3 in the second, so we'll have to multiply the first equation by 3 and reverse it. Let's do that up here. So if we reverse it, we get 3V, 3 plus, plus 3H2O in equilibrium with 3VO, 2 plus, plus 3 2s or 6H plus, plus 3E minus. We're now going to combine these two equations. The electrons should cancel, 3E minus. The hydrogens and waters will cancel to some extent. Try that. Add the two left-hand sides together and the two right-hand sides together. Here's the answer coming up when you're ready. Should have got this. Moving on. Pause and have a go, please. So nitrous acid can act both as an oxidizing agent and as a reducing agent. Now when I see potassium permanganate, right away that I see that as a strong oxidizing agent, so that's going to be the oxidation, that's going to cause it to be oxidized, the nitrous acid to be oxidized clearly to nitric acid. So the iron 2 sulfate is the one which must be causing it to be reduced. So if we see this as two parts, what's happening then is the iron is going from a +2 to a +3 oxidation state. And in this particular case then, the nitrogen of the nitrous acid must be going from its +3 oxidation state to its +2 oxidation state. So this is the iron in this case is being oxidized because the oxidation number is increasing, you would state, and the nitrogen here is being reduced because its oxidation number is being reduced. In this particular case, you must be getting NO gas, nitrogen monoxide. In the other instance, what's happening is the permanganate ion is going from Mn, which is in the plus 7 oxidation state in the permanganate, and it's going to the Mn plus 2 oxidation state, so it's being reduced, whereas the nitrogen in the form of the nitrous acid is going from the plus 3 oxidation state to the plus 5 oxidation state in nitric acid. This is the difference between the NO2 minus and the NO3 minus. So this is oxidation numbers increasing, so this is oxidation. 4 marks, so all of those would need to be brought out clearly. Moving on, pause and have a go. We're talking here about going across from sodium to magnesium to aluminium to silicon, phosphorus, sulfur, chlorine, argon. So which one has a metallic chloride that has both covalent and coordinate bonds present? AlCl3, the chloride of aluminium, according to the chem guide site here, aluminium chloride is actually covalent and should not be represented as shown here with the positive and negative ions. But if you were to imagine it initially as being ionic, the aluminium ion is a very small, highly charged ion, which means it's got a high charge density. This causes it to have a considerable effect on the nearby electrons of the chloride ion, so to speak. In the case of aluminium chloride, the electron pairs are dragged back towards the aluminium so much, or to such an extent, that the bonds become covalent. Now, if two of these AlCl3s approach, we see them here. If you consider this to be one of them here, and this is the second one, as they approach, they form these dative covalent bonds here and here. So you can see, represented by the arrows, we have these coordinate or dative covalent bonds, and then these are the normal covalent bonds. So write the formula of the metallic chloride. That would be Al2Cl6. What about this question? And note it's looking for the element. Which element forms an oxide in which its oxidation number is plus 5? Well, let's have a look at all of these, the oxides of all of these. If you stop and figure out the oxidation numbers of the elements in each of these oxides, it's going to be plus 1 here, plus 2, plus 3. We're looking for plus 5, remember. Plus 4 here. What about here? Plus 5, this is our answer. Here it would be 6 2s, and it would be plus 3, plus 6, plus 4. Sorry, this would be, this case is going to have to be plus 7, plus 1. So this was our answer. It's phosphorus forms an oxide where we have the plus 5 oxidation state. So which element? I assume you would be marked wrong if you wrote the oxide phosphorus pentoxide. It did say the element, so be careful. Name the element which forms an oxide with a giant covalent structure. Which of those at the top forms an oxide with a giant covalent structure? The answer, of course, silicon. Silicon dioxide, or silica, looks like this. This is the repeating unit. Sorry, here. A silicon surrounded by 4 oxygens tetrahedrally. And it's a giant covalent solid. So name the element. Silicon. moving on. Pause and have a go. Amphoteric. An amphitheatre is one where you can see the spectacle from both sides. The word amphi means both. What they're looking for is here that it's a substance that reacts with both acids and alkalis for the mark. So there are substances that react with both acids and alkalis. Now in this particular case, aluminium oxide is going to react with an acid, so it'll behave in this instance like a base, reacting with the acid, forming a salt and water. Write the balance symbol equation there. If you're ready, here's the answer. Sorry, I don't have the answer. Let's go back and let's write it out for you. So we have the oxide Al2O3 plus the sulfuric acid. What would the salt be? Aluminium sulfate. And water. And how would we balance that equation? We'd need to take 3 here and 3 here. Yeah, that's it balanced. Moving on, pause and have a go. So these hydrogens are going to have to be in the cis position, so have them on the same side of the carbon-carbon double bond. So something along those lines would be cis. In other words, like this. See the two hydrogens on the same side of the double bond, both above and same here. Or it could be done out like this. Again, hydrogens are on the same side and here as well. Pause and have a go. Glycerol is the old name for propane 1,2,3-triol, so let's do that alcohol out. And it has its OH groups on here, its hydroxyl groups. And then this acid, linoleic acid, they will come in here like so, HOOC. If we do it back to front, C17H31, do another one here, HOOC, C17H31, and a third one here, just doing it back to front. And the OH comes off the fatty acid, and the H comes off the hydroxyl group of the alcohol, like so. That forms three molecules of water, and then we get the ester linkage. This is an ester in each case because we're reacting the hydroxyl group of an alcohol with the carboxyl group of a carboxylic acid, and that will give us the fat. So it wanted the structure of the fat. It's going to look then like this. It's going to be CH. And we'll have this linkage. This part is the remainder of the alcohol. And then we'll get here C double bond O, C17H31. There's various ways you can do this. Go CO as well, C17H31. Plus those three water molecules. That's the structure of the fat. And try this bit here. Recall what the iodine does, if you can see this. Well, it's just showing you here an example of the formation of a different fat. In this case, the fatty acid is palmitic acid, but it's still glycerol, propane-1,2,3-triol. It's showing, as I did a moment ago, the H of the hydroxyl group reacting with the OH from the carboxyl group, forming the water. And that would happen in triplicate, forming the fat. Again, we see this ester linkage. What's happening then with the iodines? Well, the iodines go in here to saturate the carbon-carbon double bond. And this here, again, this is your triglyceride fat. So we've got one carbon-carbon double bond in each of these fatty acid residues here. So we'll need three I2 molecules. The double bond has disappeared now, it's become a single bond, and the iodines have gone in. So that particular, for every molecule of that triglyceride, you would need three I2 molecules to saturate it. So the more double bonds you have, the more iodine will be required to saturate the fat or oil. Here are some examples of oils and their iodine values. You see the iodine values increase here. So sardine oil is the most unsaturated in this table, and this is reflected by it having the highest iodine value. It takes the most iodine to saturate sardine oil. And the answers then, we see this ester linkage here, which is drawn out very simply in this case. And the answer to part three, got to bring out the fact that it indicates that sunflower oil is more unsaturated. In other words, it's got more of these carbon-carbon double bonds because we see that its iodine value is bigger. Pause and have a go, please. How would you work out the iodine value? Key thing is you're going to be using a Ouija solution. Which is a solution of iodine monochloride. You'll mix it with the fat or oil and you'll put it in a dark cupboard. You'll also do a blank, in other words, one that does not have any fat or oil added to it. You'll then carry out a titration with sodium thiosulfate. That will require a starch indicator, and you'll give the color changes. It'll go, you'll titrate first of all until it's straw yellow, then add the starch indicator, which will make it go blue-black, and you'll continue adding the thiosulfate until it goes colorless. This is what the Ouija solution looks like. The more of these carbon double bonds you have in the sample of fat or oil, the more the colour of the Ouija solution will fade. When it's removed from the cupboard, you will carry out a titration with sodium thiosulfate solution, colourless clear solution, put in the burette. It'll start like this. You'll titrate until it goes this yellow colour, at which point you'll add fresh starch indicator and it'll go blue-black, and then you'll titrate until it goes colourless. The mark scheme answer. You take a known mass of the fat or oil for a mark, you add your Ouija solution and place it in the dark. You also add potassium iodide, we'll pick that point up later. You prepare a blank, in other words one without the sample of fat or oil. You titrate with sodium thiosulfate using starch indicator, and it goes from blue-black to colourless. Plenty of places to pick your marks up. Next 10 slides help you to revise both saponification value and iodine value, questions that came from earlier papers and questions that were therefore discussed in earlier snapcasts. Can you define saponification value? Here's the answer. Did you get this? The number of milligrams of potassium hydroxide needed to neutralize the fatty acids formed by the complete hydrolysis of a gram of fat. You must know that exact definition, very likely to come up. Moving on, try this question. How do we express concentration? It's the number of moles in a cubic decimeter. This rearrangement triangle helps you to work out one from the other. So we need to work out the number of moles of hydrochloric acid needed to neutralize the remaining potassium hydroxide. So the moles of HCl used, well, it's going to be moles. If you cover moles, you'll see that mole is concentration times volume. So the concentration of the hydrochloric acid is 0.1 times the volume, which has to be changed into cubic decimeters, 0.0133. So that's 0.00133 mole of HCl. Now HCl and KOH react in equimolar amounts. So if there's that number of moles of hydrochloric acid used, there must have been that number of moles of potassium hydroxide remaining. So there was 0.00133 mole of KOH remained. Now the number of moles, I could have done this simpler perhaps, but the number of moles of KOH that we started with was, if we use the same relationship, mole is concentration times the volume in cubic decimeters. We started with 0.1 times 50 cubic centimeters is 0.05 dm cubed. So that's 0.005 mole. So we see that we started with 0.005 mole and we've ended up with 0.00133 mole. So that means that 0.00367 mole of KOH was used. We need to work out that in terms of its mass. The relative molecular mass of potassium hydroxide, KOH, well, potassium is 39, oxygen is 16, and hydrogen is 1. So that comes out as 56. So this is 0.00367 times 56 grams of KOH used. And that was based on this mass of sample, 1.05 grams. So if we divide by the mass of sample, we should be able to get the value, the saponification value we need. So that turns out to be 2.055 grams. We have to change that, remember, according to the definition into milligrams, so we multiply that by 1000. Sorry, that's 0.2055 grams. Multiply that by 1000 to change it to milligrams, and that comes out to be 205.5 milligrams. And to work out then the saponification value, it's going to be the number of milligrams divided by the mass in grams, which is 1.05, and that gives us a figure of 195.7. Moving on. Pause and have a go at this question. Here are the answers. the number of grams of iodine which will react and saturate 100 grams of fat, and hardening is the addition of hydrogen across the carbon-carbon double bonds. Notice the recommended catalyst nickel. Why do nutritionists advise our diet should be low in saturated fats? For Mark, simply looking at the link between saturated fat and heart disease. That's the main thing they're looking for there, or possibly to obesity as well. But we should eat less fat, and the fat that we eat, it's better to eat unsaturated or polyunsaturated fats. They're less linked with bad cholesterol, which is known to be linked to heart disease. Pause and have a go. So I've seen this before. Triodine has a relative molecular mass of 884, and one molecule contains three of these carbon-carbon double bonds. Use your definition and calculate the iodine value of triolene. Have a go. And here's the answer. Again, the number of grams of iodine required to saturate 100 grams of the oil. Well, so if we have, as it states, three carbon-carbon double bonds, that will require 3 moles of I2, or 6 moles of iodine atoms, each with a relative atomic mass of 127. It tells us that the molar mass is 884, so a mole, or 884 grams of triodine, will require 762 grams of iodine in total. So if 884 grams requires 762, what would 1 gram require? Well, we divide 762 by 884, we get 0.8 grams of iodine per gram of triolene. The definition involves 100 grams of oil, so we multiply that by 100, and we have 86 grams of iodine required per 100 grams of the fat. The iodine value is then 86. So that revises some of the questions on iodine value and saponification value from earlier papers and earlier snapcasts. Moving on, returning to this paper, pause and have a go. You've got three carboxyl group or carboxylic acid group, so you'll require 3 NaOH. And just as you have learned for ethanoic acid, when it reacts with sodium hydroxide, it'll form the salt of the acid, or COO-Na+, and water. So this happens in triplicate here, with each of these. So you'll end up then with the product, CH2COO-Na+. H2O. Moving on, pause and have a go, please.